Welcome everyone to this webinar hosted by Toradex entitled Beyond Development Horizon. My name is Brandon Shibley. I'm CTO at Toradex and I'm coming to you from Seattle. Before diving into the webinar, let me cover a few organizational points. Please use the chat window of the webinar tool if you have any technical issues or wish to let us know. At the end, we will also do an interactive question and answer session. You can type your questions in the chat window at any time and we'll pick them up at the end. The webinar will be recorded and made available for on-demand viewing. And so with this, let's get started. And we'll talk about how our world is evolving. It's increasing complexity driven by more features, connectivity, the need for more data, and ways to take action on that data. With all that complexity, the connectivity comes risk, more regulation, the need for improved security, uncertainty, which drives the need for agility, adaptation, and iteration. DevOps. Hopefully some of you are familiar with the concept of DevOps, the practice of removing the wall between development and operations, shortening the development cycle time, iteratively improving quality by continuously delivering software to production. And let's not forget security. We ought to ensure that security is a consideration from the very beginning and at every step in the cycle. We call that DevSecOps, but we shouldn't limit ourselves to thinking about software alone. This isn't important to the broader business. Risk, uncertainty, market changes, disruption, opportunity. Change is accelerating alongside rising complexity. Think about that. Change is accelerating. Meanwhile, complexity is increasing. Sounds like chaos. Sure, this era of mobile devices and web apps, it's easy to use, and even a toddler can navigate this stuff with a touchscreen, but we all know under the hood, it's layer upon layer of abstraction. The systems are actually much more complicated. They're less deterministic. Put them in the hands of users and unexpected things will happen. You really can't assume that you can just build such a thing in one shot and it's perfect. The Lean Startup, it's a book. It's famous for popularizing terms like minimum viable product or the concept of a pivot. It also talks about the build, measure, learn cycle. This iteration concept is fundamental to agile methodology and DevOps and software. It's also applied to businesses in the Lean Startup, and this monstrosity on the screen, BizDevSecOps, is, in some annoying way, bringing all the concepts together. This represents the methods by which we deal with this increasingly complex world. So here's a bit of data to support my assertion. We like to collect data at Toradex, and all of this data on this slide comes from our own surveys. 97% of respondents, essentially 97% of you, report having deployed products with data connectivity. More than half of those are connected to the internet, and another 35% are considering to add internet connectivity to their products. In talking about how the world has changed, we at Toradex feel like we know our customers fairly well. We do direct sales, direct technical support. We survey our customers in order to best serve you. And this data is telling. Even the more traditional or conservative industries are changing. IoT is real, and I know what a lot of you are thinking. You've been doing machine-to-machine communication for decades, but I assure you these statistics are different from what they were a short number of years ago. 90.3% need to update the software on deployed devices. On the flip side, that means that almost 10% of you ship it and forget it. Or perhaps updates are simply somebody else's problem. Nevertheless, 90+% of you are dealing with this challenge, and the majority of you, 76%, want to update your products remotely. Approximately 60% of respondents are using or are considering to use cloud-based device management, monitoring, and software update services. Finally, a minute 3.94% of respondents tell us that security is not a concern. The remaining 96% are concerned about security in one form or another, most predominantly exploitation of their connectivity, execution of untrusted software, applications gaining unauthorized system access, among others. So let's talk about what this transformation entails. IoT is a key theme here, which is essentially two important concepts, interconnectedness, which allows access and control. And in my opinion, the internet part of IoT is really about interconnectedness. This is kind of important. I quipped about the machine to machine earlier, but this is really a key distinction between machine to machine and in IoT. And that M2M, which is a node to node communication, whereas IoT is about interconnectivity among many nodes. It could be many things, many services, which leads me to the second important concept, data, essentially leveraging that interconnectedness for insights. And Deloitte published a report about IoT. The link is at the bottom. Within the report, Deloitte describes four key business opportunities for IoT, which are, first of all, cost reduction. Connectivity and data enable increased efficiency and reduced operational costs. One of the biggest complaints I hear from you, or perhaps it's from your customers, is that you have to service your products in the field. For example, a technician must be dispatched physically to a device or system to service it or update it or troubleshoot it. That's costly, right? A human needs to travel somewhere to work on a system. And what if you have to do something like an update on thousands of devices that are geographically dispersed? And if you're doing preventative maintenance, then you're sending these people out on a periodic basis, regardless of whether the system really needs to be serviced. Businesses can save serious money by centralizing the monitoring of all their deployed systems to determine if they're still healthy, only taking action if necessary, and of course, potentially troubleshooting and resolving some issues remotely without ever having to dispatch a human on site. And of course, this is just an example, but there are various other ways to save costs by centralizing the device management. The next opportunity is revenue growth. The combination of data and interconnectivity has the potential to deliver greater value to customers. You've probably all heard the saying, data is the new oil. There is value in data. You can gain insights into how your product is used, what users value, and what isn't working. These insights allow you to react and tailor solutions to maximize impact. Data and persistent interconnectivity enable completely different business models. Subscription services are a natural opportunity for a connected system, leveraging data and the ability to deliver value on an ongoing basis with recurring revenue. There are opportunities to deliver new features after a product is deployed, whether as a product update or as a paid on-demand upgrade. The third opportunity is security and safety. With remote monitoring, systems have the potential to report in real time on abnormalities or detection of security or safety issues, and potentially immediate action can be taken remotely to address the issue. And finally, the fourth opportunity is quality control, which with more feedback from these systems in the form of data about the system, how it's being used, the errors or the anomalies that are detected, developers and operators can centrally monitor all this data, improve the quality of the product, and update systems with improved software or configuration. So let's use the opportunity now here to take a poll. I'm curious for you. Which of these four IoT business opportunities are driving your interest and or selection of data connectivity or cloud services? I'll give you a moment to fill in the survey. Okay, there's our results. Well, it's actually quite evenly spread, interestingly. The top two are revenue growth and security and safety, followed closely by cost reduction and quality control. So that's actually really interesting to hear that you're all seeing all four of these as being opportunities for you. Thank you. So let's go on here because there is one additional piece to this transformation. We just talked about the IoT part of the transformation, but let's also talk about DevOps. According to a Forrester Consulting thought leadership paper published earlier this year, and this paper is available from the Q Companies website. The URL is at the bottom. 95% of respondents they surveyed say their firms experience delays because of their product development challenges. Now, that probably doesn't surprise any of us, but that's a huge percentage. Their key finding is that traditional embedded development practices are insufficient when building smarter digital products. The paper says that agility across the development cycle is important to serve customers, remain competitive, and accelerate go-to-market. And continuing with some of the data from this report, one of their stats says 82% of respondents agree that they need to quickly introduce new smart or connected products and services to maintain or grow market position. And again, 82% agree that higher level software tools and development frameworks are crucial to accelerate new product development. Now, this report cites lack of iteration as one of the key challenges, lack of iteration. This is not shown on the slide, but a quote from this paper, 68% of decision makers say maintenance is important for effective development. Products that are difficult to fix, impossible to update in the field, or have a reduced duty cycle disappoint customers and reduce product profit margins due to increased break-fix costs and warranty claims. That's one reason 78% of decision makers assess support for over-the-air upgrades as a critical or high priority. It's also driving 76% of respondents to focus on remote diagnostics and troubleshooting. So, DevOps, what does it really mean? As you can see from the graphic, it's an iterative set of practices and cultural philosophy and tooling that ties together development and operations. Commonly, development and operations are two different departments. Maybe in your organization, they have different names, but the effect is likely similar. A product development team develops a product. They call it V1.0. They throw it over the fence. The entity on the other side of the fence, maybe it's another department like IT. Maybe it's a different company. Maybe it's the customer. They now own and operate the product, and it's their responsibility. What happens if there's an issue with the product? Maybe there's a support channel. Maybe you can file a bug. Maybe wait for V2.0 to come out. The idea of DevOps is to get rid of the fence between development and operations. Try to make the flow seamless and make it continuous. Adopting a DevOps culture can empower your organization to embrace and learn from feedback that can be used to iteratively deliver a higher quality product. And when you apply automation to these principles, you can continuously integrate, test, and deliver. The data we've just seen tells us that in this increasingly complex world, that this is what is needed to achieve high quality. We need to become highly iterative, ship early and often, continuously even, and hence the need for connectivity, for monitoring, for remote update capability. And finally, DevOps is ultimately supporting some broader lifecycle objectives listed here. Allow me to quickly describe some of these: configuration management, revision control or change control, immutability. Here I like to use the analogy of pets versus cattle. When you have 2 to 3 devices, you can treat them like pets. You can give them special names. You can individually care for them. When you need to troubleshoot or fix one of those devices, you can connect to it, execute commands that are needed to nurse the device back to health, install any software you need along the way. But imagine you've got thousands of devices in the field. It becomes non-scalable. So rather than treat them like pets, we want to treat them more like cattle. We apply a common policy, automate across the herd or the fleet, ensure all devices run the exact same revision of software. We want to avoid configuration drift, where over time these thousands of devices become different because then they become unmanageable. So the idea behind immutability is to ensure that device software and configuration doesn't deviate from the baseline. When we deploy a specific revision of system and application software, that is exactly what will remain on that device until we formally update it. Next is quality assurance, ensuring the right level of testing and qualification is performed, iteratively improving quality in the process. And then automation and reproducibility. Automation allows us to continuously test and deliver a product, and it makes it reproducible to consistently do things the same way every time. We value having a predictable and reproducible delivery pipeline. And finally, traceability, knowing what change is happening, why we're making change, and being able to audit what has happened along the chain of events. It's useful for understanding what change has occurred and if something went wrong, why it went wrong. So let's cap this section off by trying to compare the present versus the future. And let's think about a hypothetical case of a traditional industrial product company who has a successful product with thousands of systems in the field. So for them, the present represents their existing product and the future represents their next generation product. For the present, they did not use data connectivity for insights or remote access or control, nor have they developed a DevOps culture or practices. But for the future, they have embraced a DevOps culture, automation, and have incorporated connectivity with the capability for remote access and control, real-time monitoring, and over-the-air updates for continuous software delivery. So if we have a look at the table here, we look at how are they able to iterate in the present versus in the future. Well, in the present, it's slow, right? Because they lack the connectivity, they lack the culture for rapid iteration. Whereas in the future, they have the connectivity. They also have a culture of being able to iterate their product on a more rapid basis, and therefore they can iterate rapidly. How are issues reported? Well, in the present, they don't have the way to monitor their devices remotely. So usually how they become aware that there's an issue is customers report it. And usually customers, by the time they report an issue, are somewhat frustrated with the product. Whereas in the future, there could be device monitors in the product which can identify issues before they become noticeable by customers. If we act quickly on such issues, we can maybe even fix them before customers experience them in the field. How do they troubleshoot issues? Well, in the present, this usually requires an in-field visit because there is not a way to remotely diagnose those systems. Whereas in the future, with remote access, it's possible to do this remotely and therefore immediately can do this much more quickly. So how often can they update? Well, in the present, right, we're not highly iterative, and we also don't have an easy way to deploy updates. So we only update when issues are catastrophic. Whereas in the future, not only do we have the culture, but we have the tooling. We can update as frequently as needed. So anytime there are an issue, we can take care of it quickly and update our product. How are updates deployed? Well, you know, in the present, we don't have the connectivity. So we have to go with physical media to the device to perform an update. Whereas in the future, we have connectivity via the network or the internet, and we'll be able to use this connectivity for deploying software. And finally, how are we managing devices? Well, in the present, we're really not able to manage devices in this fleet-like way or like cattle, as I mentioned. We're really having to manage them individually. But in the future, with the right connectivity and the right services, we can manage them as a fleet. And so this becomes much more scalable. So, you know, additionally, the next-gen product has the potential to deliver greater value with real-time insights, greater quality with on-the-fly risk mitigation, and improved scalability with lower operational costs. So the question for me to ask is, how would you like to undergo such a transformation? Well, let's talk about what Toradex can enable you to achieve with such a transformation. Allow me to give you a brief introduction. Toradex is an embedded computing company with the mission to make embedded computing easy. And we've extended our mission to make remote management of connected embedded devices easy. We have offices around the globe to provide regional sales and technical support. Toradex supports customers from consultation, development, production, and into operation. I mentioned making embedded computing easy. Toradex offers hardware and software products that are designed, integrated, and maintained to simplify the development and operation of connected embedded systems. We do that with a platform called Torizon, the foundation of which is our reliable system on modules. Those are the little modular computers on the lower half of the screen that can be embedded into all kinds of different products, such as industrial equipment, medical devices, transportation systems, and more. We offer our hardware together with full-featured, secure, open-source software to quicken your time to market with the reduced risk of a ready-to-use, integrated, and maintained Linux operating system with built-in automotive grade over-the-air updates and device monitoring. Well, as I mentioned, some of the top industries we serve include industrial automation, healthcare, transportation, test and measurement, smart city. I mean, the list goes on. Automotive, agriculture, building automation. Suffice it to say, our products are used in many different applications. Our typical customers have volume requirements of a few hundreds to a few ten thousands of products that they produce per year. And Toradex itself has thousands of active customers. And now allow me to give you a closer look at Torizon. Torizon is a free, easy to use industrial Linux software platform from Toradex. Very important for us is the modern DevOps practices such as continuous integration, testing, and delivery, allowing us to provide frequent, stable releases of Torizon software that you can confidently integrate and build upon. As you can see from the animation, Torizon facilitates the frequent delivery of software into production and real-time monitoring of deployed systems. Torizon utilizes an automotive-grade secure update framework called Uptain, and you'll learn that security is key to the architecture of Torizon. Now, this is the full-stack view, as I like to call it. The hardware I briefly touched on, we have a bunch of material and other webinars focusing on our hardware products at the bottom of the stack, so I won't dive deep there today. But these products are the foundation of our Torizon stack, and we specialize in providing these products over a long life cycle of 10 plus years. And, you know, the board support package that we develop is tailored and optimized for serving this hardware. But the rest of the stack is open and is able to be used on a variety of other platforms. Torizon Core is the operating system. It's comprised of extensively used open source software such as Linux, the Yocto project, Docker, Debian, and more. And it can be used out of the box and tailored to a multitude of different use cases without the need to build the OS completely from source code. It's designed to be used with containers, allowing a wide variety of software to be deployed on top of Torizon Core. And so if we dig in a little deeper here, Torizon Core is built with the Yocto project. It is possible to customize it with the Yocto project. However, because we provide it as a binary distribution, you can use it right off the shelf from Toradex without the need to build it from source code. And we provide some tooling to help you configure it and deploy software on top of it. You can see here that you know, it's comprised of Linux, a file system utility called OS Tree, which is how we are able to revision control the file system of Torizon Core. It's got system D, there's Actualizer. Actualizer is actually the over-the-air update client. It works together with OS Tree, talks to the Torizon IO backend, is able to perform updates by, you know, telling the system to upgrade from one revision of a file system to a different revision, takes care of transferring the files that need to change to perform the update. It can do things like rollback. We also see FluentBit in the system here, which is our device monitoring agent. So this is able to collect data from throughout the system and provide it back to the cloud side of things. And then we've got Docker, which is the container engine. This is what, you know, manages and executes containers on Torizon Core. And we've got containers themselves. So this is how our customers typically deploy their application on top of Torizon Core, is within a container. And the advantage of using a container is that it can be independently managed from the operating system. So you could deploy these things in lockstep, but they can also be managed with more independence than traditionally done with like a full system developed with the Octo project. So there, due to that decoupling, we can have a different environment in the container than from the OS, and you can develop the application much more independently. It also allows for working with a wide array of software from this container ecosystem. Now, if we turn our attention to the Torizon platform services up on the top there, these are tools and services that help serve Torizon Core, providing services like over-the-air update, fleet management and monitoring, remote access and control, among other things. And these are services that are provided on Torizon.io and are used to be able to do that fleet level management, continuous delivery of software, and things like that. And there's even more, including tools and services like our Easy Installer, the Torizon IDE extensions that can be used for developing applications, Torizon Core Builder for customizing Torizon Core, our Pinout Designer for helping you develop your carrier board to work with our system on modules, and so on. A substantial value of working with the Torizon stack is that Toradex is developing, integrating, maintaining, and thoroughly testing and providing frequent updates to this full stack. So you're not locked into this stack. It's much of it is free and open source. In fact, that's a really important value for us, is to keep this stack open, extensible, adaptable. So this gives you a lot of flexibility to take or leave what you like. But for anyone assembling their own solution stack, you undertake significant effort to integrate, stabilize, maintain, and keep up to date that stack and all the components for the life of the system. So by using Torizon, you can significantly reduce your risk, lifecycle effort, and cost, and significantly speed time to market. Now let's talk a bit about the developer tooling. Now I talked to you already a bit about Torizon Core. It's our operating system. So let's jump directly to the Visual Studio Code extension. This helps facilitate you to build, debug, deploy containerized applications using a variety of languages and runtimes using Visual Studio Code together with Torizon. This is a great tool for development. It's not a focus for us in this Beyond Development webinar, but definitely check out our other webinars, resources about this. It's a really great tool. The another key point here is the software ecosystem. So I mentioned our use of containers opens us to being open to a wide ecosystem of software, because you don't need to tailor the operating system to the specific needs of, you know, every software package you want to use. With containers, you provide this sort of compartmentalization that allows to be able to deploy all kinds of different software environments on the system. And so there are many container images on Docker Hub that are compatible. You can work with software from our partners, such as Codasys, Ozone, Crank, TotalCross, among many others. And from Toradex, we're also providing some other reference images, like our Debian base images and demos of various other software solutions that can run on Torizon. Let's talk a bit more about the remote updates. Like I mentioned, we're using Uptane. It's a secure update framework developed in automotive and is the de facto standard for over-the-air software updates for vehicles. And as I mentioned, the update client actualizer works with OS Tree, and it allows to declaratively deploy a checksummed OS file system revision to a fleet of devices. I mentioned immutability earlier. You know, the think about pets versus cattle. This is extremely powerful for managing or really revision controlling the software across a large fleet of devices. And it supports rollback to a previous file system revision. It's both storage efficient, more so than AB update systems due to OS Tree's use of hard links on the file system. But it's also bandwidth efficient on update. It only transfers the files that need to change. For container updates, we utilize Docker. And Docker is also quite efficient in that it only transfers layers of a container that change on update. Device monitoring. On Torizon Core, we use a client called FluentBit. It's lightweight, fully configurable, and supports various plugins. And we have a tool called Torizon Core Builder. It's used to customize Torizon Core without having to rebuild the image from source with the Octo project. It simplifies applying changes such as device tree overlays, system configuration, compiling out of tree kernel modules. So you can do quite a bit with it without having to go and rebuild the OS. It also provides a way to declaratively define these changes in a configuration file, which also makes it really nice to integrate with CI/CD systems, as we'll get to see a bit later. And it also can automatically sign and upload Torizon Core and container packages to Torizon 4 OTA updates. All right, now let's talk a bit about the fleet services we're providing on the cloud side. You know, starting with fleet monitoring. This is providing monitoring of the health of devices, working with the device monitoring agent that I mentioned. We're also monitoring the state of core services like Docker, monitoring device resource utilization. That's things like the memory, CPU utilization, temperature, disk IO and stuff like that. And upcoming, we have even more features we're rolling out in this area. Being able to aggregate more logs, device and fleet notifications, you know, detecting anomalies within the fleet, things like that. So there's a lot of cool stuff coming. For fleet management, there's ways to manage fleets of devices, manage software and updates on the fleet level. And longer term, we're incorporating additional fleet control and automation features. But even today, we have the ability to manage fleets of devices, perform updates on those fleets, and things like that. Remote access as a service. This is something that is coming. It's not yet released. We're working on a remote shell for access on devices and providing various control capabilities. But already today, we have WireGuard VPN and SSH that are available already on Torizon Core. And in terms of extensibility, we have an API that we're preparing to go public. It's in a private beta at the moment. So those of you that are interested to work with an API, we can give us a shout out. We can try to hook you up. The idea is that Torizon isn't trying to solve every problem that's out there, right? What we looked at was what are the most common issues that our customers experience and how can we help like you guys overcome those challenges. And there are of course many other things that aren't that not every one of our customers experiences, but that you guys have at least unique challenges that you want to overcome. And so an API allows that opportunity to extend on what we're doing with Torizon and to also do some unique solution development together with the solutions that Toradex is providing. So with this, I would actually like to perform another poll. And in this poll, the question is, who controls, maintains, or monitors your products once they are deployed in the field? That could be your products development team, could be your companies, like a separate department, like your operations or IT team, or it could be your customers or your customers' customers. Let us know. I'm curious to hear about this. Obviously, is an important criterion understanding how you can best manage devices at scale. All right, so we see our results here. An interesting split. I mean, the most popular is actually, it seems, for folks to, you're building a product, you're delivering that to customers. Perhaps there's even another line of customers after that, but somewhere else, there's folks responsible for operating, maintaining devices. But for some of you, it's your company developing a product, and it's your development team, or it's another department who's doing this operation and maintenance. So interesting results. As you can imagine, there are unique challenges regardless of the situation. And we would love to hear more about the details of this, by the way. So we'd love to hear your feedback. What unique challenges that you are facing there? All right, so security and reliability. Well, these are key to Torizon, as I mentioned. We understand that for our customers, these are some of really important considerations. I shared some of the data with you early in the webinar. How are we able to help address these things? Well, starts with frequent updates. We believe, you know, if there are quality issues, if there's a security vulnerability, it's important that you can be able to update software. Like I mentioned, we live in a more chaotic world, more complexity. We're not going to get everything perfect the first time through. I mean, we'll never get to market. So we have to be able to update things once they're in the field. And Toradex provides quarterly releases of Torizon Core, but also nightly and monthly developmental pre-release software for preview testing. So you can find out from Toradex quite quickly if something we're working on, it helps you overcome a challenge or has, you know, maybe it's a feature of interest by utilizing our pre-release software. And you can use our quarterly releases to make sure that you can keep your software in production up to date and frequently update it. And of course, if you work with Horizon, you too can release and deliver updates frequently by integrating your software on top of our frequent software releases. Now, we mentioned the automotive grade security with Uptane. Uptane is designed for the broad threat model of automotive. We believe this broad threat model is also applicable to many industries that we work with. It goes beyond what most update systems are able to address, including things like, you know, verifying updates for secondary processors and delegating authority to other software suppliers or fleet operators. But also, very importantly, the architecture allows users of Torizon.io to take their keys offline, which ensures that even if Torizon cloud services were to be compromised, your devices would remain safe in these, you know, environments like in hospitals, in vehicles. This level of security is crucial. And additionally, Torizon is designed to be fault tolerant. It's tolerant of sudden power cuts, even during update. It supports automatic rollback of software in the event of a failed boot up. It supports hardware watchdog for triggering reset in the event that the system becomes unresponsive. And Torizon Core can perform integrity checks of its file system. And finally, we're working on secure boot integration, beginning with our NXPI Dynamics-based products using high assurance boot. And so with this, I'm going to show you a little bit of a demonstration. And I want to first describe what I'm about to show you. So what we're going to show is continuous delivery when working with Torizon. Now, this is a relatively common looking, continuous delivery pipeline. You can see these stages of the pipeline. It all begins with revision control and then integrating software, being able to verify the software, deploy it into our OTA service. And then the OTA service takes care of delivering it to devices. And, you know, we want to be able to test it first on a test fleet, make sure everything's good, usually review that the update is looks successful, and then ultimately deliver it to production. So this is a fairly typical pipeline, I would say. You know, you may have more or less steps as needed. It really is meant to be tailored to, you know, the specific needs of an organization and of the product. Now, underneath the pipeline, I tried to identify, you know, what systems were involved here. So we've got our, you know, on revision control, this is using source control management. In our case, we're using GitLab in this example. For our CI/CD framework, we're using GitLab CI. Now, of course, any combination of tools is possible here, right? We have, could be using GitHub and GitHub Actions, could be using like the Atlassian tools, could be using a whole wide variety of things, you know, maybe Jenkins for CI/CD. The idea is it's really adaptable to, you know, maybe the tooling you've already are working with. And then ultimately, it's about getting the software into Torizon.io for the OTA service to be able to deliver to devices. You also see here on this slide that in the integration, we're using some other tools also, like our Torizon IDE and development tools for doing some of the integration, using Torizon Core Builder for doing the configuration and deployment of the operating system. So I'll show you what a bit of that looks like in this walkthrough. I just want to emphasize again that we start with revision controlling everything about the system, the OS, the application, et cetera. I've seen so many cases where folks kind of do this as an afterthought, and then they don't actually have a very good sense of what got deployed into production. Or, you know, they can't track the changes that they've made very effectively. So this is really important. Using Git source control to declaratively define and control the software in production is called GitOps. So this workflow I'm going to show you is an example of using GitOps to manage the software that goes into production using Git, specifically GitLab with Torizon. In the demo, you'll see me using Visual Studio Code with the Torizon ID extension, but I don't want, you know, I won't be focusing on the development in the demo, you know, so please check out our other resources to see Torizon ID extension in action. And what I'll be focused on is the GitOps flow to integrate and deploy a new revision of both an application and the OS, specifically Torizon Core, to a test fleet. For both the application as well as the OS, the pipeline shown here is, you know, the general sequence of events that are used, committing a change to a Git repo, which automatically triggers integration, optionally some verification testing, and then deployment of software to the Torizon.io. And Torizon.io provides the software delivery to devices. So with that, let's get into it. Yeah, hopefully you see this okay. I'm in Visual Studio Code, as I mentioned. I have a Python app application pulled up here. I have the Torizon ID extensions. You'll see we have a device connected, although we're not going to debug and deploy software on the device right now. I'm going to make a change here into the application. We'll assume that this this works well, and we're going to commit it to our application repository. And when I do so, GitLab is going to automatically start integrating and deploying this new version of software to Torizon.io. And so what you can see here actually is the script, or that's a CI script for GitLab that it describes how to integrate it. So there's a build stage, which does the integration. There's a deploy stage, which deploys this into Torizon.io. Now it's building an application container with this Python application, and that container will be able to be deployed on our devices. Now I'm going to show you actually the same exact thing for the OS. So we did this for our application. I also want to show you what this looks like for changing Torizon Core, the configuration. So let's start by having a look at this configuration file. This is how we describe to Torizon Core Builder how, you know, what kind of declaratively describing the image that we want to assemble. So it tells us which image from the Torizon repository to integrate on. We're going to use our 5.4 quarterly release of Torizon Core to then apply some customizations to. So this input section is about starting with this image that comes from Toradex. And then we're going to also see that we can apply some customizations. If we go down a bit here, there's some file system customizations that can be overlaid. You know, we can change things like device trees, make changes to the kernel. We have this output section, which also allows us or tells us, you know, how we're going to output the final image. Anyway, I'm going to make a really simple change. I'm just going to enable a new splash screen here in the image. And then we're going to similarly commit it to a repository where GitLab will kick off the integration and deployment of the image. So that's what's happening here. And again, our integration script has the two stages, build and deploy. And then when we go to the Torizon.io side, well, here's the script, a build stage and a deploy stage. When we go to Torizon.io, we'll see that both the application package as well as the OS package have been deployed there. So let's jump over there. You'll see here, this is the landing page at Torizon.io. So you'll see your recent devices and recent packages that are available. Also our fleets that we've recently used. Now we have quite a few different fleets and devices and things in our system here that we are using for the demo. If I go to our packages, we're gonna see that the top packages are OS, and we have our application package. And if I go to the devices, I can select a fleet, which I can use to push an OS update. So I'm gonna first start with deploying first our OS update. Now I could deploy both simultaneously. However, I just want to show that, you know, have this flexibility, right? You can update the OS a little independently of the application. So we're going to first deploy this 5.4 image that I built. And, you know, it'll take normally a few minutes. So what happens in this process is that the devices are occasionally pulling the server, and they'll realize that there's an update available. And then they'll pull it down. And, you know, like I mentioned earlier, the system is smart in that, you know, it only transfers the files that really need to change on the system. So from that point, the update can go relatively quickly as there is not extensive changes. So that was successful. And now I can update the application package as well. So I'll quickly do that. Take the latest version of that package. So what you'll see is if you've integrated the same package over and over again, you have you know, a history of different versions. It allows you to make sure that you're putting the right version into production. You know, and in this case, we probably first do this on our test fleet. And then when we're happy with what we're seeing on the test fleet, we're confident we've run through our qualification testing, then we can make the decision to deploy the same software into production. So we're seeing that the update is in progress here for our application. The devices are pulling down this container and going to redeploy it on the device. And let's see. Now when it's done, and we're seeing that some of the updates have been completed. Click on one of these devices and look at the installed software. We see it has the new version of our packages, both the OS package and the application. And if I click on more detail, I'm going to show you one of our other features here, device monitoring. We're seeing on the device the memory utilization, the CPU utilization, CPU temperature, also the status of our Docker service. And so this is a helpful way to keep track on what's going on with the devices. One of the features we're continuing to iterate on. So, you know, This is, again, where getting your feedback is super helpful for knowing what other things are really helpful for you in managing your devices. So that's the end of the demo I have today. I want to get on to questions. Let me get back to you. Great. So let's open up for questions. Before I start with the questions, let me also suggest go check out Torizon for yourself, app.torizon.io. If you go to torizon.io, you'll see the information about the features, the tiers that are available. There's a completely free tier, and then there is also a commercial tier with the added features. Check those out. If you've got a Toradex device, you can test Torizon.io today. And we would love to get your feedback. For us, again, talking about iteration, right? We are iterating frequently, and your feedback is crucial to us ensuring that we're putting our focus in the right places and making the product better. So we'd love to get your feedback. Please check it out. Let's get to questions. The first question is, what is the pricing for Torizon? So the pricing, let me break it down like this. The only thing that we're charging for on Torizon is to use Torizon.io, which is the hosted services from Toradex. You can use Torizon Core and many of the tools completely free. In fact, they're open source. That costs nothing. And even as far as the services go, at Torizon.io, we have two tiers. One tier is completely free, which you can use. It does have limited capabilities. For example, you can't upload your own custom images, which is a rather important constraint. But if you're using software directly from Toradex, it works nicely. And there are some other commercial tier features that are only a part of the commercial tier. Now, the commercial tier, you'll see the information at Torizon.io, but it is starts at $2 per device per month. That's the current pricing there. There's a question about how does OS Tree work? OS Tree is, I mentioned, is a file system utility that we're using to revision control the file system. It's a very interesting and helpful application. It's a core part of our OTA technology. We did a whole webinar, a 30-minute webinar just about OS Tree. I would suggest take a look at that at webinars.toradex.com. You can also find it on YouTube. We've also got documentation at developer.toradex.com. So I don't want to go into all the specifics today, but it is, in short, we describe it as Git, but for file systems. So if you know about the Git workflow, you can use a similar kind of workflow working with OS Tree. So check out those resources. There's another question here on how to use a CI system with Torizon. So that I did not go into depth on. I mentioned we're using GitLab CI in the example that I gave. You can use many different CI systems. They can incorporate Torizon Core Builder into one of the, into the integration stage, for example, and you can use it in the deploy stage to push software into Torizon.io. And this should be possible with many different services. How to use them? Well, there I would have to maybe suggest checking out some other resources. We have our developer center, like I mentioned, developer.toradex.com. You probably need to spend some time getting to know the CI service that you're intending to use, as that will be a really important aspect. Reach out to us if you've got more specific questions. We're happy to help you with this process. We provide free technical support, at least for the things that we're that are related with our products and that we're knowledgeable on. If we can help you with the free technical support, we'll try to at least get you going in the right direction or finding another resource to work with. The next question, how can you compare Torizon to Debian? Well, Debian is a Linux distribution, has an extensive package repository. It's also why we use it in containers with Torizon. So you know, it's commonly used as the operating system. We use it within our containers, and it's the, you know, the default environment we use. We base our container images off of Debian because it does have a nice package repository that, you know, our can be used with our devices and on Torizon. But the OS itself, in our case, is like I mentioned, built with the Octo project. It's a minimal Linux operating system with support for containers. And then the whole idea is that work within the container to build your application environment. So if you want to build your application in a Debian environment, that is completely doable using Torizon. The next question is, does Toradex support Torizon in medical device space? As in, is Torizon certified for medical devices, or does Toradex provide support in getting it certified as part of the product? Well, I will say that we work with medical customers, building medical products. Toradex itself is not, building medical devices ourselves, right? Our products do get used in medical devices. It's usually our customers that are going through that certification process. Of course, it depends on, you know, what level of medical device and, you know, what the certification requirements are. But we're always happy to try to assist or provide consultation. So again, as far as it relates to our products. So, reach out to us and let us know specifically what, you know, maybe what challenges you're having or how you could use some help from us. We're happy to have a conversation and see if there's some help we can offer, you know, in terms of helping ensure that you can configure our software or, you know, design a carrier board to help pass this kind of certification. And there's a question about, what about real-time applications on Torizon? Is this feasible? And of course, we always have to qualify what you mean by real-time, right? There's quite a broad range of possibilities here as far as real-time is concerned. We do have builds of Torizon that are called real-time because they have the preempt RT patch applied to the Linux kernel, which makes the system more responsive to, you know, certain, you know, higher priority tasks. So that, I would say that it is potentially feasible. You know, in fact, we believe it is usable in some real-time applications. You know, what we might consider to be a more soft real-time with, you know, maybe responsiveness requirements in the, let's say, hundreds of microseconds to the millisecond range, right? If you need to get down to, let's say, sub 100 microsecond guaranteed responsiveness, we might not want to, we might want to suggest some alternative options. Like some of our products have, Cortex M, you know, microcontroller cores on the same chip as the application processor. Those, you know, using this can enable you to achieve much a very high responsiveness, suitable for those more hard real time applications. But in any case, Torizon can be used in conjunction with such things, and I would say it is suitable in real time applications. But of course, depending on the specific requirements you have. And again, like I said elsewhere, reach out, let us know specifically what you're interested in doing, because we'd love to A, learn more about your application, and you know, we're always trying to learn. But the other thing is, we can give you more specific guidance if we know specifics about what your needs are. Let's see. And with that, I think we're out of questions. Is anybody else have a? Oh, we got another question coming in. Is it possible to use multi-core in Docker environments? And the answer is yes, of course. So many of our products today, most of them are now, you know, they're multi-core. application processors. So, you know, you're leveraging the multi-core capabilities with, you know, the Linux operating system, specifically Torizon Core, and of course the containers, you know, which little side note about containerization in Linux. I mean, you're still using the Linux scheduler to execute container workloads. So it's really not drastically different from executing applications direct, you know, without containers, right? It's just we're providing some compartmentalization of resources, a little additional isolation, but same scheduler, same kernel, you know, using the same processor cores. Now, what you maybe, you know, just referring back to the mention that I mentioned that there are Cortex M cores as well as Cortex A cores on some of our chips. There, it's not so, you know, the microcontroller code is not running inside the Linux container environment. So just to clarify that, when you have these heterogeneous environments or architectures, the Linux is running on the Cortex-A cores. On the Cortex-M cores, you can run either like code bare metal or on top of like an RTOS, like free RTOS. And they can communicate to each other between, you know, Linux and FreeRTOS using inter-process communication via shared memory. And this is something we're working on to support with Torizon. Yeah, with that, I think we're out of questions. So I'm going to thank all of you for joining the webinar today. It's been a pleasure to chat with you. You'll see the recording coming out in the next week or so. Additional resources, please check out developer.toradex.com. You can check out other webinars at webinars.toradex.com. Contact us directly to have a chat. We'd love to hear from you, get to better understand like what needs you have, what challenges you're facing. We want to also hear your feedback about Torizon. We'd love to get to know what you think. If you get a chance to use it, your feedback is so important. Please contact us. And with that, we'll see you in the next webinar. So wish you all a good day. Take care. Bye-bye.